So in my career as a landscape photographer, I've tried a few things by now, but I have never been followed by like 5 Shetland ponies who are just, they're just hungry, I guess, but they have lots of grass. They start eating my tripod. Yeah, they're kind of cute, but also a bit annoying. So yeah, beautiful, beautiful first scene right here. Like, this is probably one of the most beautiful places I have seen in Denmark. Wow. It's very much like Lake District-ish vibe to it, but in Denmark. So, as I just showed, lake out here. We have some lake here, then we have some land, some trees, and some background trees, and then we have the fog coming in. And what I want to talk about this morning is how you can always get nearly perfect, optimal exposures for a camera. It's actually very simple. It's simply just so you do not underexpose your photos, so you have plenty of data to work with in editing, whether you want to edit or not. And the first thing you want to do, especially if you have a Sony camera, is to turn off Dynamic Range Optimizer, also known as Auto HDR. So it's fairly easy to find in your camera menu, or hard, depending on how you see it. It's just in the first menu and then in number 12, and then it's called DRAW/Auto HDR. You just go in and turn it off. Very simple. And the reason why you want to turn that one off is simply that it gives you a false impression of the back screen and simply of your exposure. So turn that one off to begin with. So a thing you absolutely want to avoid is to rely on the screen on the back of your camera. Because as it is right now, looking out over this scene here, and then I look at the back of my camera, we can even compare it like this, it actually looks fairly well exposed. I even have it down here on zero, so a neutral exposure. However, I have also my screen set to sunny daylight brightness mode, which means it is artificially just boosting the brightness of the preview on my screen. So even though it looks well exposed, the raw file, the data file, is actually underexposed. And especially on days like this, where we actually have a relatively flat scene, the exposure will just end up being gray instead of like whitish and having the dynamic range the scene actually has. And that's because all cameras want to expose in the middle-ish, so like 50% gray. And that is what they go for to get optimal exposure. But we as humans, we know better, we know the data. So you, for the most part, want to expose to the right. So what does exposing to the right really means? Exposing to the right simply just means that you expose to the right of the histogram. I'll show you the histogram in a minute. And that means that you are overexposing your photo a little bit, and then you bring back down the brightness in post-processing. In that way, you should have a much cleaner file than if you exposed what the camera would say is the optimal exposure. So in last week's video, I got this very beautiful photo of the sun coming up between some trees, and I actually really, 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 really like that photo. Right now I'm also photographing the sun coming up behind the trees over here, and with the atmosphere and the fog, it's very beautiful. So as you can see here, I'm just very, very minimal, isolating the tree lines and then the sun there. I'm zoomed all the way into 200 millimeters, so I can't really get further in. But I don't think I should either. It looks really, really nice. When it comes to the exposure, it's not really a huge deal. The sun is going to be overexposed for the most part. When there's some fog in front or a cloud in front, maybe you can save the exposure. But for the most part, I'm just checking with my histogram, which you can see right here. And you can actually see that my histogram right now looks as if most of the information is straight in the middle. So this here is the composition. And I actually have a neutral exposure. And because the sun is simply so bright, there's no chance I'm going to save it. And in this particular case, just to have kind of an average exposure, I think I will just stick with a histogram where most of the information is here. If you look very closely, you can see this little dot down there in the corner. That is the sun. So I'll just explain how a histogram works. A histogram simply just shows the brightness values of your scene. So there's no right or wrong histogram. It just analyzes the scene and gives you information. So over here you have the shadows. So you can see I do have some shadows. That must be the tree line. And then over here I have some highlights. The further towards right you go, you have the highlights. That is why you want to expose to the right for the most part. And in this case here, I have the highlights over there. So when we look at the scene, it looks like this. And I'll just put on my histogram there. You can see this spike over here on the right. That's the sky. Then we have the sun down there in the corner. And then the shadow part here, or the data we have here in the shadow area of the histogram, that's the trees. And you can see if I change the exposure, I change the histogram. Now I'm just turning up the exposure. I'm making the exposure brighter, so the histogram is being pushed towards right. And if I make the exposure darker, then I'm pushing the histogram towards left. And that is basically how a histogram works. So always, always, always check with your histogram. You want to have most of your data well within the histogram. So either in the middle or, as I just talked about before, exposed to the right. But in this particular case, with the sun where it is, I'm not going to overexpose it too much. If you want to learn more about composition in landscape photography, be sure to get my two ebooks. In both of them, I cover a range of what I call compositional tools. They've got loads of 5-star reviews and the feedback is overwhelmingly positive. You can also get the two free light versions and check those first if you're in doubt whether you want them or not. There are links to everything down in the description. So I just want to show you really fast how it is with exposing to the right. And as you can see here, I've actually come back to the first scene again, because now the sun has come up and lighting the scene differently. You can see I have my histogram on, and if I just increase the exposure down here, see up, 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 I'm moving the histogram to the right. And as long as I am not pushing the histogram all the way up towards the right part there, I should be home free to get an exposure where I have as much light in the scene as possible. And then I can just bring it down, bring down the brightness in post-processing, and then I should have a cleaner file. Because the more light you get on to your sensor without overexposing, theoretically, the cleaner the photo will be. what I really came for this morning was this here, right here. Look at these beautiful trees. And then we have the sun coming in, lighting up the fog, throwing these beautiful, beautiful sunbeams into the scene. Harsh light in a forest environment can be notoriously hard to expose for. And the thing I do for the most part, especially on silent morning, is aperture priority F16 ISO 100. There's no leaves that moves, so it's all good. You may want to shoot at a lower aperture, but not too low. If there's a little bit more wind, and maybe higher ISO. But if you're in doubt about your exposure, because your histogram is very, very, I guess you can see here, it's very dark. All the information, the forest environment is very far to the left. And then I have the light all the way over here as a little dot. And that is basically just the background here on the right side of the histogram. So what I do is I simply just go in and then I start to bracket. So continuous bracketing. And for the most part with this camera I have here, two stops in between with three images. And that usually does the trick. As you can see, my middle exposure is underexposed with one stop. If I don't need all three images, fine, I'll just choose the one that's most optimal. However, if I do need more, then I have three photos that I can put together in an HDR file. So that is the main way I come around high dynamic range scenes, which this one is. And what a wonderful scene it is. So I'm playing a little bit around with all these beautiful gnarly trees, getting the sunbeams in. I have a composition that looks something like this here. It looks really nice, I think. So I'm using this foreground tree here to frame the scene, and then I have this bended tree here, and then I have the sunbeams there in the background. It looks really nice. The last thing I want to show you is that there's also this thing called zebra stripes. And zebra stripes, yes, as the animal, is simply just an indicator where you can see on the back of your screen where you are overexposing. Now, you put on zebra stripes via the menu in your camera. So on a Sony camera, you can see it's on menu 2, and then it's in number 6, and then zebra setting. And if you go into that one, you can turn it on and off, and zebra level. Now, zebra level, you can choose a few different ones here. You can choose everything down to 70 and then up to 100 plus, and then you can make some custom profiles. I have it on 100. Now, what does that mean? 100 simply means that, as far as I've understood, that as long as the zebra stripes are there in your screen, when you can see them, as you can see right now, this gorgeous, gorgeous scene right now. There are some zebra stripes, but I'm not sure you can see them. But if I turn up the exposure, then you can see all this pattern here. That is what zebra stripes. And wherever the zebra stripes are, when I'm on 100, I'm good. I'm not overexposing where the zebra stripes are. But anything beyond the zebra stripes, everything that is completely white, there I'm overexposing. So if I'm just turning down my exposure, you can see how the whites are retreating, then I should be fine. So here, zebra stripes, good, and everything white, not good. So that is how I use my zebra stripes setting. Oh God, this scene here is just absolutely incredible. Well, here's the photo. So is this here the photo of a lifetime? I'm shivering right now. What's the chances? I have some deer. You can't see them on this camera. I will film them right there. And you can see the sun streaks. See, oh, it's lone. It's lone now. It's only standing there, right in the middle. Oh, no, it won't focus. There. Just getting its attention. I don't want to frighten it or anything. I just want to have it look over here, and I'm just hammering off. Now, I have it on timer with continuous shooting. I don't care too much about the exposure right now. The scene is actually relatively flat, even though there's so much light. So f16, ISO 100 and half a second shutter speed. And that is actually fine because the deer is standing completely still. So in that way, as long as it's not moving, I'm just getting completely sharp photos right there. Oh my. And the best part is, I've gotten it both in horizontal and in vertical. I will zoom a little bit more in here. Ooh. Oh, this is perfect. Ooh. This is so much more than what you could wish for. So much more. Just perfectly placed right there in the middle of the trail. Horses, deers, goats, all the good stuff this morning. Here's the photo. Sometimes you're just so, so, so lucky. So, so lucky. So, anyways, I want to say a big thank you to Ole, who I found this location on Instagram. It was tagged probably some like Danish landscapes or something like that. And he told me where it is. I have tried not to copy his compositions from this location, and I don't think I have because I haven't been able to find them. Also, of course, check out Ole's Instagram. I have it down here. And yeah, if you want to learn how I edit my photos, be sure to check out my Photoshop for Landscape Photographers post-processing course. I've designed it so it's very easy to get started with Photoshop. Whether or not you're used to Lightroom, I am going through it in a very progressive way. You can pick and choose everything you want to learn and what you want to use in your Photoshop editing on your photos or where the limitations are for you. I cover basically everything I know, from the most basic all the way up to blending with luminosity masks, editing with luminosity masks, and yeah, all the good stuff that you ought to know as a landscape photographer who also do post-processing. So yeah, there's a coupon code down in the description. I also hope you learned how to expose properly for almost any condition and how to use your camera for it. So as always, I would highly appreciate both a like and a comment, and be sure to check out all the links down in the description. Thanks for watching.